really blessed with the opportunity to have Professor Miklos Telek with us.
Thank you very much. Can you hear? I think this was the longest CV which you can find on the internet. I'm so sorry for that. Okay. Preparing for this talk, I had the problem of not knowing the general knowledge of the audience. And I think that I have the problem that there are several world-famous experts of these subjects, and there might be some who just start dealing with this subject. So it is very hard to find the proper level to explain things. I try to... maybe this needs to be switched off. I try to rather be introductory, and it might even be a bit boring for those who are very much familiar with these things. So, yeah. The short outline of the talk is I try to define the starting point where I start from. After that, based on this, I partially repeat what was already said about phase type distributions, and I am going to enter more into the details. After that, we look at with some extensions, based on the background of phase type distributions, we are going to converge towards describing point processes, and I am going to introduce the set of Markov variable processes. And during the talk, I am going to provide some kind of outlook towards subjects which are going to be covered by the consecutive tutorials. So, the basis. I assume that you are familiar with continuous time Markov chains. Okay. Over here, XT is going to indicate a continuous time Markov chain. And in this talk, the Markov chain we are talking about is going to have a finite state space. So S is a finite set. In this particular case, it is, it contains n states. And the key thing is that the infinitesimal generator is a matrix which describes the behavior of this Markov chain. And it has got two kinds of elements, the off-diagonal elements, which are just describing the transition rate from state I to J, and it is going to be a non-negative number, and we have got the diagonal element of this matrix, which is negative number, okay, so the minus 1 times the diagonal element describes the exit rate, the speed at which the Markov chain leaves state I. And this number is computed such that you add up all the transition rates to the neighboring states and multiply this with minus 1, and you get this diagonal element of the generator matrix. And this simple fact is going to be described by this notation. This notation means that you have got a column vector of 1s, and if you multiply the generator matrix with this column vector of 1, then it computes the row sum of all rows of the matrix. So it says that the row sum of the matrix is going to be 0 due to the fact that the diagonal element is computed as the sum of all the other elements multiplied by minus 1. Okay. In case of continuous time Markov chains, we usually have two main questions. One is the transient behavior, one is the stationary behavior. The transient behavior can be defined as the probability of being in state J at time T, suppose that we start from state I at time zero. And it can be computed as a matrix exponential function. Particularly, it is the ij element of a matrix exponential function. If we have a matrix Q, which has got these properties, then we can assume a continuous time Markov chain, which is described by this matrix Q, and all the elements of a matrix exponential function, e to the qt, is going to be non-negative, because it has got a nice stochastic interpretation. It is a state transition probability matrix. State transition probability. And it is just described that the elements of this matrix are not only non-negative, but they sum up to 1. And this is just that if you multiply the stochastic matrix with this column vector 1, then all of these terms, due to that property, is going to be 0, and only the initial term gives you the unit row sum for all the rows. Okay, so this is what I call continuous time Markov chain, and if you kind of modify the concept, then it is possible to define a transient Markov chain. So maybe it is easier to start such that I give you an example. Over here we have got a Markov chain which has got a single absorbing state, and we have got this kind of state transition structure. In this talk we are going to number the states such that the first sum states are going to be transient, and the last one is going to be the absorbing state. If the Markov chain has got this structure, it has got a single absorbing state and all the other states are transient, then the generator matrix has got this structure. So here we have a matrix A which describes the transient part. Here we have column vector A which describes the transitions from the transient state to the absorbing one. And we don't have transitions from the absorbing state to the transient one, so that's why we have got a row vector 0 here. And due to the fact that the diagonal element is computed as the sum of the transition rates, the diagonal element is going to be 0 as well. So that's the structure of the Markov chain if it is composed of n transient state and one absorbing. Over here, due to the fact that the row sum of the Q matrix is always 0, vector A can be computed as the row sum of all the elements of A multiplied by minus 1. So coming back to the previous page, we can say that based on this concept, we can define so-called transient Markov chain. Transient Markov chain is the same concept as before. The off-diagonal, and it can be described by a transient infinitesimal generator matrix. It is such that the ij elements are non-negative, and they describe the state transitions from I to j. Diagonal elements are negative, and it describes something. It describes the sum of all the transition rates to the other states, other transient states, and it also contains the transition rate to the absorbing state. So basically, this diagonal element is composed such that it contains the information about the speed to the transient state. And similar to the Markov chain properties, the matrix exponential term e to the at defines the transition probability to state I to state j in time t. but this sum is going to be less than 1 due to the fact that the Markov chain can move to the absorbing state before time t. So it is a very important property that whenever we have got positive state transition probability from state I to state j, it means that in a transient Markov chain, it means that the Markov chain, for example, went from state I to state 5 in time t, it had to be such that it have never visited state 6 because it is absorbing. So if once the Markov chain moved to state 6, it is not going to visit anymore the transient state. Okay, maybe it was a bit too detailed, but we are going to build on this concept quite some time. Over here, it is just that the analysis, I mean the structure of the transient Markov chain is such that you can compute, or the matrix exponential of QT contains the matrix exponential of AT, which is obvious also based on the stochastic interpretation over here. So let's consider the properties of this transient Markov chain. First of all, we have that the Markov chain is going to converge to the absorbing state after some time. So as time goes to infinity, the Markov chain is going to stay in the absorbing state, so the probability that it is in one of the transient states is going to be zero. It also means that this matrix exponential function e to the AT has to be such that it converges to zero, so A must have all the eigenvalues with negative real part. And it is an obvious consequence that A is non-singular. And the matrix minus IT minus A minus 1 has got a stochastic interpretation, which is going to be explained in one of the next slides. Okay, in this particular talk, I am going to focus on the case when the Markov chain starts from one of the transient states. There are papers which deal with the case when it can also start from the absorbing state, but we are not going to consider that. So how to compute, so after this introduction, let us define once again phase type distribution. We define random variable t, which is the time to arrive to the absorbing state. That's the random instant when the Markov chain moves from a transient state to the absorbing one. As I said, we assume that the Markov chain starts with probability 1 in one of the transient states. So the random time t is defined as the time to reach the absorbing state. And this, indeed, describes a random variable, a given random distribution, with the help of a Markov chain. And we are going to analyze the distribution of this time. So we can say that the distribution of the time to reach the absorbing state, which can be described as the probability, I mean, based on the probability that it happens before time t, is just equivalent with the probability that the Markov chain is already in absorbing state at time t. So here, state n plus 1 indicates the absorbing state, and the first n state are the transient state. So the probability of being in the absorbing state at time t is equivalent with not being in any of the transient states at time t. So over here, we can compute this probability based on the fact that we are not in any of the transient states at time t. And this probability can be computed based on the initial probability distribution, so the probability that the Markov chain starts from state k, and the probability that the Markov chain experiences a state transition from state k to state I in time t, and it has to be computed for all the initial states and all the transient states. So forming a row vector of the initial probabilities and having these matrix exponential and summing up all of these elements gives you this kind of vector matrix based description of the probability distribution. So over here we have got that the distribution of t, or CDF of t, is just 1 minus alpha times e to the at times 1, which means that alpha is a row vector of size n, a is a matrix, n times n matrix, and e to the at is an n times n matrix as well, a stochastic, sub-stochastic matrix, and this 1 is a Coulomb vector containing only 1. So based on this simple result, we can compute the distribution of the time to absorption, and this is practically a description of a distribution. So vector alpha and matrix A describes a given distribution according to this expression. And this description contains n minus 1 parameters in vector alpha. I said n minus 1, it is composed of n elements, but the sum of these n elements is 1, so I would say that there are n minus 1 free parameters in vector alpha, and there are n square free parameters in matrix A, because the size of matrix A is n times n. Okay, whenever we are going to try to fit this kind of distributions, these numbers play important role. Based on the density, or based on the accumulated distribution function which we just computed on the previous slide, we can compute the density as well. So basically one can evaluate the derivative of this matrix exponential, and it turns out to be this matrix exponential function e to the at, the derivative of it is just the same as it was scalar quantity, so it is going to be a times e to the at, and due to the fact that column vector a is computed as capital A times 1, we have got this expression for the density, based on the density and the distribution after some algebra, it can be computed that the distribution has got these moments. Indeed, in the computation of the moments, the minus A minus 1 matrix plays important role. Okay, the case moment is somehow the case associated with the case power of that matrix. Additionally, based on this expression, we can symbolically compute the Laplace transform of the density function, which is going to be this kind of a matrix expression where we need to compute the inverse of Si minus A, and if you do it such that we compute the determinant of some submatrices and the whole matrix, then it turns out that it is going to be a rational function. This rational function is of order, numerator of the this rational function is order n minus 1, the denominator is order n, and normalizing the function such that the coefficient of this term is 1. We have got 2 n parameters, but due to the fact that the density should sum up to 1, we have got that E0 and B0 equals to 1, which means that the distribution can indeed be described by 2 n minus 1 parameters. So on the previous slide, we have seen that we have got nice descriptions through the Markov chain, which contains a matrix and a vector, and it is composed by n square something free parameters, while the distribution is described by 2 n minus 1 free parameters. So 2 n minus 1 parameters can describe all of these phase type distributions if the transient part of the Markov chain is composed by n elements. Okay, we are going to get back to that point again, but before that, I'd like to give you the nice stochastic interpretation of the matrix minus A minus 1. So let's define the time spent in state J before going to the absorbing state if we start from state I. If I again get back to the figure, then, for example, we are interested in the question, how much time do we spend in state 3 before getting absorbed if the process starts from state 1? So that is the quantity which we are going to define here. So Tij is the time spent in state J, suppose that the process started from state I. So we'd like to compute the mean of this time. The mean of this time can be computed as we evaluate the time spent in the first state. We start from state I, so we evaluate the time spent there. It is, I mean, the parameter of the, it is going to be an exponential distributed time, and this parameter is given in the diagonal of the of matrix A, diagonal of the transient generator matrix. So AII is the, or minus AII is the transition rate leaving state I. So the time spent there is just 1 over the transition rate. Is the basic properties of exponential distribution. So first we have a time spent in state I. If state I and state J are identical, then we need to consider this time to compute this time spent in state J. If they are different, then this time does not play too much role. So we introduce this kind of tricky symbol delta ij, which is usually referred to as Kronecker delta, which takes the value of 1 if I equals to j, and takes the value of 0 in any other case. So basically, the time spent in state j is going to be the time spent during the first state, during the stay in the first state, which is in the first term, and after that we have got a given state transition to a next state. If it is a transition to the absorbing state, there is no more time which we need to compute over here, no more time which we need to consider. Otherwise, we move to one other transient state, and we might ask the same question again. So we move to state K, and we might ask the question, how much time do we spend in state J starting from state K? These nice and easy to interpret expression gives us a description of the behavior. Basically, what we can do over here, just multiply both sides with minus AII, and we can figure out that the missing elements of this summation is going to turn on the other side of the expression. So after some algebra, we got this expression, which can be put in matrix form. So the matrix composed by these Kronecker delta elements is just the identity matrix, and we have got the elements of the transient generator matrix, and this T is the matrix of the expected time spent in the states. So finally, we obtain that the nice stochastic meaning of this minus A minus 1 matrix is the time spent in a given state. Suppose that we are starting, I mean, the process starts from a different state. In this part, the ij element is the time spent in state j before absorption if the process starts from state I. Okay. It was also mentioned during the introduction that the set of phase type distributions are very nice, because what we can do, basically, we introduce the set of distributions, and these distributions are described through Markov chains. So whenever we would like to compose new distributions based on this one, we just need to play around with Markov chains. So over here, what we have is that we have two phase type distributions, x, which is described by vector alpha and matrix A, and y, described by vector beta and matrix B, and we'd like to compute the sum of these two distributions. So what do we need to do? Basically, we need to kind of, so we have got this first distribution and its transient state somewhere here, so we need to compute the time getting to the absorbing state. As soon as we arrive to the absorbing state, we just immediately jump. I would put it in a different way, because it is not the regular Markov chain transition, but it is intuitively, it is an immediate jump to the next phase type structure, which is going to be described by matrix B, and we compute the time spent here before going to the absorbing state of this second matrix structure. So what we need to do, we need to describe this behavior of the Markov chain through a generator matrix. So what is going to be, it is on the screen. First, we describe this part of the behavior with the sub matrix A over there. After that, with the column vector which describes the transition to the absorbing state, we jump to the absorbing state, and immediately we are going to start the next phase type distribution according to its initial probability distribution, which is defined by vector beta. And this part of the matrix describes that when the first phase type structure finishes, the second starts, and we obtain a new vector matrix pair, which is a bit larger Markov chain, which results in the distribution of the sum of the two original phase type distributions. So this was one operation which turned to be closed for phase type distribution. So if we have any two phase type distributions and we generate the sum of the two, it remains to be a phase time distribution. After that, we can look at to the mixture of two. The mixture of two phase type distributions. So let's suppose that the random variable z is defined such that it takes the value of x with probability p and takes the value of y with probability 1 minus p, where x is a phase type distribution as before, y is a phase type distribution as before. What is going to happen in this case? We just need, again, the same game or same play around with the phase type distribution. So what we have got these same two Markov chains, and we need to start from this structure with probability p and from this structure with probability 1 minus p. And it can be managed such that the initial vector describes this kind of two different starting options, and the matrix is generated according to the two phase type structures. It's getting more interesting to compute the minimum of two phase type distributions. So for that, I would come up with a simpler example. We have got a phase type distribution of this structure. So it is composed of three states, and we have got these transition rates. And I would say that this phase type structure is pH alpha A and pH beta B, and we'd like to compute the minimum of these two phase type distributions. So basically, if we consider the cross product of these two, then we obtain a Markov chain. This Markov chain is going to have 9 states. And out of these, we need to distinguish between the different parts of this state space. So what we have over here in these parts of the state space, we have that all the two, I mean the first one and the second one, are still in the transient part. When we move here, it means that the second phase type is already completed, and the first phase type is still in the transient part, and so on. So basically, this part of the state space indicates the cases when both of the phase type distributions are still in the transient part, which means that we need to know only the time spent here, and the first exit from this part of the state space is going to result in the minimum of the two phase type distributions. Okay, how to describe it? I don't really know how much are you familiar with these kind of operations, but there is a given algebra which is referred to as Kronecker algebra, used to describe the behavior of, can be used to describe the behavior of two independent Markov chains. It is composed based on these rules, so the Kronecker product of two matrices can be computed like it is a matrix of the size of if it is n by m, it is l by l, then the size of the generated matrix is going to be n l times n l, and it has to be generated such that the 1-1 element of the first is multiplied with the whole B matrix, and so on and so on. And additionally, the Kronecker sum can be described as based on the Kronecker product operation as A times an identity matrix and identity matrix times A. And I'd like to give you the associated stochastic interpretation, which I think helps a lot to write this kind of equations. So when you have two continuous time Markov chains, then two independent continuous time Markov chains, then you can be sure that the two Markov chain will not move the same instant. I mean, the probability of moving both at the same time is negligible, it's zero. So what happens in this case, either the first Markov chain experiences a state transition and the second doesn't do anything, or the way around. So basically, this Kronecker sum expresses the property that either one moves and the second does not do anything, or the second moves and the first does not do anything. I mean, these are the only possible state transitions. Okay, so accepting that this operator can be used to describe the behavior, we can see that this part of the state space describes the time of the minimum of the two random variables and the transient matrices are enough to describe this behavior. So the transient part of the matrix is which is described by matrix A and matrix B. Okay, I emphasize this because next we can consider the maximum of two phase type distributed random variables. So what is going to be the maximum? Okay, the maximum is when both of the Markov chain arrive to the absorbing state. So the maximum is going to be when we arrive to this state. That is going to be the maximum of the two phase type. I would say it is just a kind of game with Markov chain models. How can we describe it? Basically, it contained the first, the part which is this part of the state space. After that, we might have two kinds of transitions. It is incorrect, of course. Either we finish the first phase type, the column vector A, which describes the transitions to the absorbing state of the first one, and derive this part of the state space. In that case, we remain to complete the second phase type. So that is described here. If we finish the first one with the column vector A, then we remain to complete the second part of the second phase type distribution. The second Markov chain needs to move to the absorbing state. Or the way around. What was the way? Okay, this was. So the way around means that the second phase type completes, we arrive at this part of the state space, and after that we remain to go to the absorbing state of the first one. So once again, after some game of with the Markov chains, we obtain the new initial probability vector and the new transient generator matrix, and we can describe the maximum of the two phase type distributions. So we already had so many operations which are closed for the set of phase type distributions. Any of these four operations does not drive us out of the set of phase type distributions. Okay. Okay, so right now I am going to confuse you a bit as far as I can. So let's consider this phase type distribution over there. It is a very simple one. We start with two states, and it is just to relate the transition graph and the matrices which you see here. So with probability 0.2, we start from state 1. 0.2, we start from here. 0.8, we start from here. And what are the transition rates? 0.4. I keep saying 0.4 from 1 to the absorbing state, and 0.2, okay, from here to here. And that is the key point, that the generator matrix should contain information about the rate to the absorption. What are the rates to the absorption? Over there, we have got 0.4, and the exit rate is 1. So we have got a transition rate from this state to the absorbing state with rate 0.6. In the case of the second state, we have got a transition to this state with 0.2, and the overall exit probability is 2, so what we remain to have is 1.8. is going to be the transition rate to the absorbing state. So over here, we completely define the Markov chain. So these are the transition rates. These are the initial probabilities. Of course, if you want, you can add that the initial probability in the absorbing state is 0. And we need to compute the time to reach this absorbing state. So over here, there's a function which plots you the distribution. I mean, for this particular Markov chain, this is the distribution to reach the absorbing state. Okay, let's take another example. Here we have the next example. Yeah, by the way, I just don't follow the time. So someone please let me know when I'm supposed to stop. I'm supposed to stop already?
11 o'clock, sir. 11.
11, yes.
Yeah.
And what's the time now?
11:05.
Okay, actually, I just started this, which might... Okay, 2 more minutes, and you have the coffee break. Okay, the example. Basically, over here we came up with another example. Different numbers, I'm not going to put it on the board anymore. But what we see is that, yeah, with a different Markov chain, we get a distribution which looks very similar. And the fact is that it is not very similar, it is exactly the same distribution. So what we have is that different Markov chains can result in exactly the same phase type distribution. So the alpha A, or the initial vector generator matrix description of the phase type distributions is not unique. You might have quite a lot of different Markov chains which results in the same distribution. And I think I stop here, and we can go on after the break. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
So basically what we have seen before is that more than one Markov chains can generate the same distribution, same phase type distribution. Over here, we have got a way to generate any representation based on a given representation. Say, we have got a phase type distribution with the initial vector A and transient matrix capital A, and based on that, we can take any non-singular matrix B. Oh, it is B again. I'm so sorry. Okay. So, okay. We just take a general non-singular matrix, which has to be such that the row sum of the matrix is 1. And having this, we can generate any new representation according to the following rule. Basically, it is a kind of similarity transform. So the phase type representation is insensitive to this kind of similarity transform. Here is the kind of derivation that having the new representation gamma and g, the following these steps of algebra, we obtain back the original distribution. So due to this similarity representation, one particular phase type can have infinitely many different representations. And over here, matrix B is a square matrix. So the size of one representation is going to be the size of the other. Instead, there is an example for the case when Markov chains of different sizes might have the same distribution. It is a very particular example to represent the exponential distribution as a mixture of two of these small Markov chains. I mean, there is the given derivation which indicates that the time to absorption in the larger Markov chain is always the same as it was for the exponential. Before going forward, I would like to add one more detail. So the phase type distributions has got several important properties. Some of them we already detailed in this talk. And one which was not mentioned before is the following. If we'd like to generate a phase type distribution such that the variance of these distributions is as low as possible, then we have got a limit. Okay, this variance limit is, of course, related to the mean value. So there is a quantity which is called the coefficient of variation, which is the variance divided by the square of the mean. And this quantity is already independent of the mean, and it has got a lower bound. The lower bound is 1 over n. So with a phase type distribution composed by 10 states, the minimum coefficient of variation which we can achieve is 1 over 10. And the Markov chain which generates this minimal coefficient of variation is this simple Markov chain which I call Erlang distribution, which is the sum of independent identical exponential distributions, which might be called even gamma distribution. And there is no better structure which gives lower coefficient of variation. Okay, so why did I mention all of this? Because we try to the problem that we'd like to fit phase type distribution. So we have got a general non-negative distribution, and we'd like to come up with a Markov chain which has got exactly the same distribution. If it was possible, then it is perfect. We need to find the distribution, the phase type representation, I would say. Otherwise, we need to approximate this distribution. And to do that, we have several problems. The main problems are that whenever we'd like to fit a phase type distribution, we not only need to find a Markov chain, but we need to find one Markov chain of an infinitely large set. As I said before, these similarity transformations define an infinitely large set of Markov chains which results exactly the same distribution. So the main problem is that it would be very convenient to define one particular Markov chain which describes this distribution. And there are several cases in which it is possible to define one special Markov chain, which is commonly referred to as canonical representation. So basically what we have got an infinite set of Markov chains which all define the same distribution, and we need to pick one by some reason. What could be the reason? Usually we pick the one which has got a minimal number of parameters. So the number of parameters which we need to set in this minimal representation is exactly the 2n-1 parameters and not the n squared parameters. So the key problem is that we prefer to have very special distributions and very special representations. And if we have those canonical representations, then it is much easier to complete the fitting. And the problem is that there are no canonical representations for the whole set of phase type distributions. There are special subsets for which we have got. And these subsets are, I mean, some of these subsets are presented here. The set of acyclic phase type distributions. Acyclic means that there cannot be loop in the transient part. If there is no loop, it means that all the transient states can be visited at most once. So if we have this structural property, then we are in a very good situation, because all of the acyclic phase type distributions can be represented in a very nice structure. They can be represented with this so-called canonical structure. And this structure has got exactly 2n minus 1 free parameters. So the nice thing is that for this set of distributions, we know that there exists a transformation to this structure. And this transformation is going to be such that all of these initial probabilities and all of these transition rates are valid transition rates. Why is it important? It is important because, going back to our example, we had got a given transformation matrix which generated this matrix B and based on representation A. But we can also go forward and generate another representation, which is this one. This representation is very nasty. It contains a negative element in the initial vector, and it contains a negative, I don't know, transition rate in the matrix. So it is not a Markov chain anymore, in spite of the fact that if we use this vector and matrix, we obtain exactly the same distribution. So whenever we do the transformation to the canonical representation, we need to be very much careful, because it should be such that the representation remains Markovian. And that is not available for the general phase type class, but it is available for this acyclic phase type class. And in that case, you have got this representation. I would say that there are other special classes which are even more simpler than these. And according to me, this is a quite flexible subclass inside the class of phase type distributions, which can be used in practice. And this subclass is very nice because it also contains the distribution which has got the minimal coefficient of variation. The distribution which we have seen before is also a member of this class. So having all of this preparation, we can define the fitting task in two different ways. I prefer to use two different names for these two different problems. One is referred to as matching. The goal of matching is to generate a phase type distribution which captures some of the parameters of the distribution which we'd like to approximate. In case of matching, the most common thing is to match the first sum moments. So if we have a distribution which we'd like to approximate, we take the first 2n minus 1 moments of this distribution and try to approximate with a phase type distribution. If we try to approximate with a phase type distribution of size n, okay, let's say, we have got a distribution with 5 known moments. Then we'd like to approximate it with a phase type distribution of size 3. Phase type distribution of size 3 has got exactly 5 parameters. So what we can try to do, we can set these 5 parameters such that it exactly fits the 5 moments. And there are numerical procedures which does this job for us. So they generate a matrix and a vector such that the 5 moments computed based on this vector and matrix are going to be exactly the five moments which we would like to match. The weakness of this approach is that the obtained vector and the obtained matrix might not be a valid Markov chain, might contain negative elements in improper places. So that's the key problem with the matching approach. Otherwise, the matching approach is very appealing, but due to the fact that it has got this nasty problem, it is not always applicable. Okay, that is the case when you have got exactly the same size of the distribution which defines all the parameters. It is actually an open problem how to relax this matching approach such that you generate a larger Markov chain whose first five moments is exactly the five moments you'd like to fit, and the representation is still Markovian. Because that would be nice. In that case, we fit exactly the five moments, and we also have a Markovian representation. But unfortunately, it is still unsolved. The other problem is the fitting. Fitting, I would say, is a kind of optimization. We'd like to find the minimum of a function which is the distance between the phase type and the original we'd like to approximate. So first of all, we need to talk about distance. What is the distance between two distributions? It is, I mean, if we have a plot, we have got a feeling. But we need exact mathematical definitions. And we might define several different ways to measure the distance between the two distributions. We might define distance measures based on the CDF, we might define distance measure based on the density, and all of these distance measures has got advantages and disadvantages. I would say that the first one has got several disadvantages, and I can't really mention any advantage. So the weakness of the first one is that it very much depends on the mean. So it, time to time, it might happen that the optimization intends to find the distribution. I mean, the measure somehow depends on the mean of these F and F hat distributions. And due to this fact, occasionally the fitting is somehow moving away the mean itself. Over here, we have got a distance measure based on the density functions. So this distance measure also sensitive to the mean, but it has got the nice property that this distance measure is bounded not only from the, I mean, upper and lower bounded. Is it visible what is the upper bound of this distance measure? What should be the upper bound? I know it's nasty thing to ask questions at all. So the worst case, okay, the best case when the two functions are the same. In this case, the measure is zero. The worst case is when the two functions are completely different. In that case, you have got the integral of the first, which is one, and the integral of the second, which is one. So this second measure is in between zero and two. And the third measure is something which is associated with the entropy. We can call it relative entropy. This is a very tricky measure, which is also associated with the likelihood optimization. And without entering the detail, I would say that the first two measures are such that it has got significant value when the density is significant. Whenever the density is low at the tail of the distribution, those density measures are insensitive to the behavior. nice property of this relative entropy is that it is also sensitive to the tail behavior. I would say that this last distance measure gives you a very nice compromise between the main part fitting and the tail fitting. I mean, it might be the case that you are more interested in better fitting the tail. It might be the case that you are not interested at all in the tail fitting. If you are not interested, then this second measure could be applied. There could be just looking at the visual, I mean, plots, especially with linear scales, you might find that the fitting based on this distance measure looks nicer because it is sensitive to the main part. But if you also look at to the tail behavior, then this second fitting measure, as I said, gives a better compromise between the tail fitting and main part. So, and over here we have got the same thing which I already mentioned, that whenever we have got the Markovian description of the phase type distributions, we have got somehow n square free parameters. We have got this infinite set of Markov chains which still defines the same distribution. And we don't like that. We don't want to fit approximate one member of this infinite set. It is a very difficult optimization problem. And numerically, it behaves badly. So what we'd like to do, we'd like to pick one canonical representation. We'd like to have a representation which has got exactly 2n minus 1 parameters. And we prefer to fit according to this. But the contradiction is the following. Either we just, for example, take the 2n minus 1 moments and get a representation, and this is not Markovian. So whenever we, for example, take the moments, we cannot really know that the thing we get is going to be Markovian or not. It is not really known how much you need to tune the parameters. Okay, you might say that, okay, I'm not that much interested in the fitting of the fifth parameter, so I just move it a bit away. But it is not really known how much you need to move it away to obtain a Markovian representation. On the other hand, so if you do the 2n minus 1 parameter fitting, then you might have the problem that you don't know where are the limits of the sets in which you can search for the solution. On the other hand, you need to do the optimization with the n square parameters. And in that case, the problem is that you need to approach one member of this infinite set, which is nasty numerically. So one possible thing is, which I said, is the canonical representation. And in that case, you need to look for a Markovian solution, which means that the parameters has to be, okay, in the representation which I gave you, have to be non-negative. And if those parameters are non-negative, then you surely know that the obtained representation is Markovian. And in that case, you can be sure that whatever you have over that set is unique and Markovian. But in this case, the problem is that you don't have canonical representation for the whole phase type class. Instead, you have got a nice canonical representation for this acyclic phase type class, which I just indicated. And if you take that class, and if you perform this optimization problem. Okay, I am going to show you examples where we perform this optimization problem according to this distance measure. And tomorrow there is going to be a tool demonstration session where I can show you the fitting tool which can approximate general distributions according to any of these distance measures. So basically, applying this tool and using the acyclic phase type class, we have got this kind of fitting results. I tried to make it more visible. So in the first figure, we have got the fitting of a variable. So this is a variable distribution, and basically what we can see over here is the fitting of this variable with this given parameters, fitting of this variable with 2, 4, and 8 phases, which is a Markov chain, the transient Markov chain is 2 states, 4 states, 8 states. And what is it expected that the fitting gets to be closer and closer as you increase the number of phases. And over here, we don't really see any difficulty in at least in this figure with respect to the optical fitting of the original function. Over here, once again, the 2 by 2 does not fit it properly, but after that, we get very, very close fitting. We might also take a log normal distribution. And once again, after having 4 phases, Markov chain with 4 states, it is already a very, very nice fitting. Another log normal distribution parameters are provided on the graphs. I would say once again, it is a bit less accurate with 8 phases, but it gets closer and closer. A third log normal distribution is this one, which already indicates problems. So this is a very sharp one with a very low coefficient of variation. The coefficient of variation of this particular log normal is less than 1/8. And due to this fact, the best fitting, I mean, the fitting procedure first intends, of course, it sets the mean properly. But after that, it tends to minimize the variance as much as it can. And having 2 phases, this is the minimum which can be achieved. Having 4 phases, this, having 8 phases, that is the minimum. So this is an example where the minimum coefficient of variation play an important role. And that's why it's important to have the ability to fit distributions with low coefficient of variation. Okay, over here we have got another problem. The uniform distribution. We'd like to approximate the uniform distribution. What we obtain is that this horizontal part of the density causes difficulty for the approximation. Basically, the density of the phase type distribution is somehow the sum of exponential functions. So what we intend to do here, to approximate a horizontal line with an exponential function. So what happens is that okay, this 2 by 2 fitting is just one peak or one wave, but after that it starts waving around the horizontal line due to the addition of additional exponential functions. But of course, an exponential function can never just okay. An exponential function, a decaying exponential function, can never just get a constant horizontal line. So basically, over here there is one weakness of the phase type class, which is visible on this figure. That if we have got some density with some horizontal behavior or constant behavior over a period of time, then it has to be approximated with this kind of alternating function. Okay. I just jumped to this other distribution, which is somehow an exponential which starts from here and an exponential which starts from 1. I mean, it is the combination. A shifted exponential is added with the original one. And I mean, with probability 1/2, it starts from 0, and probability 1/2 is an exponential which starts from 1. And over here, we have the difficulty of approximating a vertical line, approximating a jump of the distribution. And also, exponential functions has got limitations in approximating this vertical behavior. So I would say that if the distribution is such that the coefficient of variation is not extremely low, there are no this kind of constant density intervals, and there are no sharp jumps in the density, then the phase type class does a good job with a low number of phases. As it was mentioned in the introduction, as you increase the number of phases to infinity, you can approximate all of these densities arbitrarily closely. It is just that it needs a lot of states, a very large transient Markov chain. So this is about the fitting properties. And so why is it good? I think that the first thing is to be explained. I just checked the time, so I'm going to. The first thing is going to be explained quite well in the consecutive tutorials, but I would say that it is also very nice, because if you have any model, stochastic model, in which you have got given activities, which can be described by any model description language. I mean, I put some example like BattleNet or stochastic process algebra, but there are several stochastic model description languages based on this kind of discrete state machines or whatever. So all of these models are practically limited to the use of exponential distributions for the activity. And if you replace the time of the activity with the general distribution, then they get to be unsolvable. If instead of having a general distribution, you replace the distribution with a phase type one, then the overall model might remains to be Markovian, and you can use the standard Markov chain analysis to solve all of these models. So that I prepared with some slides about the discrete counterpart of phase type distributions. Exactly the same thing can be said if the Markov chains we were talking about are not continuous time but discrete time Markov chains. But I'm going to skip these and go to the next question. How can we generate renewal processes? How can we generate point processes based on this discipline? So for example, the simplest question we can ask, what is going to be a process if we have got phase type distributed times one after the other? Identical distributed and independent phase type distributed times. Basically, these Markov chains are to indicate this behavior. So basically, over here we have got the first phase type time. After when it moved to the transient, the absorbing state, it jumps into immediately to the second one, jumps to the third one, and so on and so on. And if we consider the tangible behavior, then we obtain a Markov chain like that. So basically, based on this discipline of phase-time distributions, we can generate point processes. We can generate this point process whose inter-event time is not exponentially distributed, but we can still describe the whole behavior by a Markov chain. And that's the Markov chain which is indicated here. This is the structure of that Markov chain. I would say that this Markov chain looks like a Poisson process, except that instead of having minus lambda here and lambda here, we have got a matrix here and a matrix here. So these two matrices replaces the single value. So basically, on the matrix block level, we have got the same structure as for the Poisson process. And I would say that this is a kind of generalization of the Poisson process. But up to this point, it is a bit restricted generalization. It is restricted due to the fact that we are repeating the same phase-time distributions, the same thing here, the same thing here, such that they are independent and identical distributions. We might generalize this thing such that they get to be correlated. Why are they independent? They are independent due to the fact that when we finish one, we jump to the next one such that the initial distribution is always the same. It is always the alpha vector which decides the initial distribution when you start the next level, the next block. But you might relax these limitations. If you relax these limitations, you obtain a general structure, okay, which is here, which you just said, okay, I have got a given behavior here, and after finishing this, I jump to the next block according to a given matrix freely. If it was in state I, then I might jump to state I or state J, whatever. So if I completely relax the limitations that it has to be the same distribution, I just have got a matrix which describes the jump from one block to the other. And what we already obtained is the Markov arrival process. Markov arrival processes generates correlated arrivals due to the fact that the time spent in this block somehow associated with the fact that the visit to this block is finished in state I or in state J. And due to the fact that this is associated with the time and the distribution of the initial state of the next block depends on either you finished it in state I or in state J, then you obtain a next distribution which depends on the time of the previous. So you obtain correlated arrivals. Okay. Maybe it was somehow too much associated with phase-type distributions, this introduction. So instead of that, I would put another stochastic interpretation. A Markov arrival process can be defined based on a Markov chain, such that whenever the Markov chain is in state I, then arrivals are generated according to rate lambda I, and when the Markov chain undergoes state transition from state I to J, then an arrival or an event or whatever is generated with probability Pij. So whenever you'd like to write a simulator, you just sample the time you spend in state I. While you are in state I, you generate arrivals according to rate lambda I. And when this time expired, you have got a state transition. You sample what should be the state transition. If it is from state I to J, then additionally, you generate an event with probability Pij. So that is one description, and in that case the description is based on the generator matrix, these PIJ probabilities, and the Lambda I rates. Or alternatively, you can say that U, which is going to be the same, so I'm going to repeat myself, you have got a kind of Markov chain description in which matrix D0 describes the event which does not generate arrival, does not generate new event. And D1 is a part of the Markov chain which generates event. And these two matrices, matrix D0 and matrix D1, completely describe the behavior of this arrival process. Right now, I would like to say that having this general structure, it is once again the same thing which is common for the Poisson arrival process, except that it is this kind of bidiagonal structure on the matrix block level. And I think that I am going to finish with some examples. So basically, I don't know. So I thought it to be a kind of tutorial, and I thought it might have been interesting to see some examples for how to generate intuitively this kind of processes. So yeah, basically I should not show it to you, but I might ask, what should be the description of a phase type renewal process? So we have got a phase type distribution given with initial vector alpha and matrix A, and what should be the Markov chain which generates this? So it is just asking the question which was the introduction of the model. So it is not that exciting yet. But you might have met with the class of models which is referred to as Markov modulated Poisson process. It is a process which is modulated by a Markov chain. Whenever the Markov chain is in state I, you just generate arrivals with rate lambda I. In this particular case, the rates at which you generate arrivals goes to the diagonal of matrix D1, and the modulating Markov chain modified at the diagonal with these rates goes to matrix D0. Okay, another stochastic model is the so-called interrupted Poisson process. You have got a two-state Markov chain. Whenever the two states of the Markov chain are the on state and the off state. Whenever the Markov chain is the on state, it generates events with a given speed, I think it is lambda. Yeah. It generates events or arrivals with rate lambda. So what should be the description of this particular behavior? In this case, the transitions, oh shoot, it is supposed to be beta, I'm sorry. So in this case, the transitions between the on and off state are alpha and beta, and whenever we are in the on state, we generate arrivals at rate lambda. Over here, we have got some interesting properties of Markov arrival processes, which we also detailed for phase type models. So there are some operations which are closed for the set of Markov arrival processes. Over here, we have got a stochastic process, have got a point process, and for each sample, we make a decision. With probability P, we take it as a sample, with probability 1 minus P, we drop it away. This is going to be a new point process. And this new point process remains to be a Markov arrival process. All this new thing has to be described. The original one is with these hats. So the original process is described by D0 and D1 hat. And the new one is such that these are the samples which are accepted, and these are the samples which are rejected. Oh, it is once again the opposite. So I discard the sample with probability p and accept it with probability 1 minus p. It is also possible that we don't do it for every single sample, but we do it for every second sample. What it happens in this case? We need to know if it is an odd or an even sample. And if it is an even sample, then we discard it with probability p and accept it with probability 1 minus p. And the same thing can be described with a Markov arrival process. Superposition of Markov arrival process. It is so simple. It is just the Kronecker plus of the contributing Markov arrival processes. Over here, there are some use of these Markov arrival processes in queuing system. So I suppose that you might know what is an MM12 queue. So it is a queuing system with Markovian arrival and departure with a single server and one buffer additional to the server. So over here, oh no, two buffers. What is it? Zero, one, two. So one additional buffer. So what we have here is the departure process from this queue. In this queue, it is a finite buffer queue. So an incoming customer can be served or can be rejected. So we might want to describe the stochastic process, which is the stochastic process describing the customers which were served. And in that particular case, whenever we have got at least one customer in the system, then with at rate mu, where mu is the service rate, we serve those customers, and these are going to be the arrival event for the departure process. And it is also possible that an incoming customer cannot join the queue due to the fact that the queue is full, and in that case the arrival event is the one when an incoming customer arrives to a full queue. Okay, I would say that the last example I'd like to show is about the intuitive understanding of the correlation in between consecutive arrivals. We'd like to generate a Markov chain, a Markov arrival process, using not more than two states, such that they are correlated. How can we do that? Suppose that, I rename these states. Suppose that we have got two states. One is slow, one is fast. Slow means that you leave this state, you generate events in this state very slowly. Fast means you generate events very quickly. So what we'd like to have? We'd like to have that after a slow one, what positive correlation means? Positive correlation means that after a slow one, we generate the next event slowly again. So in that case, we generate an event, say, with lambda 1, and after that, we also generate events with lambda 1 with high probability. P something. And 1 minus P, we might generate fast event as well. In this case, after a slow one, if P is large, P is close to 1, then after a slow event, we are going to have a slow event again and a slow event again, which is going to result in positive correlation in the inter-arrival. Because whenever we go to the fast event, we do the same thing. So with lambda 2, we quickly generate events with lambda 2 times p, and once again, lambda 2 times p. So one fast event, another fast event, and so on, and so on. So this is going to be a positively correlated arrival stream. And the very nice thing over here is that we don't need to do a lot of modifications if we'd like to generate a negatively correlated one. What a negatively correlated means? After a fast event, we generate an event slowly. After a slow one, we generate an event quickly. So if we just change the value of p from 1 towards close to 0, then we obtain a Markov arrival process which is negatively correlated. And so this was just to indicate that this is really a flexible class of models, and a lot of algebra and a lot of properties evaluated, but I'd like to close the presentation with a statement stolen from the previous presentation. It is a very fertile research area. There are a lot of open, very nice open problems, and all of you are most welcome to contribute to this field. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your enlightening talk.